Do you feel the same about the white South African refugees? Should we be inviting them here as well?
No.
Why not?
They've got their own country and they stole their
so
land.
So do the
anyway.
Syrians. Really? The white South Africans now that are about 30 years old stole land?
No, but that's the history of the place. That's the history
of South Africa. So they deserve what? A genocide? South African farmers, you know the ones that are getting raped, robbed, murdered.
No, that's ridiculous.
Are you denying what's happening in South Africa?
Yes, I'm denying it.
A society that would embody a value system that puts black people first will have to be attained through confrontation. It's definitely coming. We are going to fight.
Will you support our petition to bring down the white South Africans? Why is that funny?
I used to learn about events in history, such as the Salem witch trials or the Spanish Inquisition, and find it so astonishing that mere accusations of heresy or witchcraft were so often sufficient for an otherwise good person or family to be marked for expulsion. Neighbours turned against neighbours, fellow countrymen became instantly hostile to one another. Often the mere utterance of a few select accusatory words had the power to thrust people into a life-destroying trial by public opinion, which so often ended with a grisly execution. I used to look back at these events and wonder what it was like to have lived under the ever-present threat of such hysterical and primitive religious superstition. But unfortunately, if we examine current events around the world, I think we have ample evidence that we do in fact live under a system of similar perniciousness. But in today's religious fervour, the word heretic has been replaced by racist, and the magic powers that we were once accused of having as witches are now the evil magic of white privilege, which apparently grants us every same supernatural capacity to surpass and oppress others. And for the last few years, the same utterance of these words has often been enough to initiate a public trial by social media outrage, and the evidence is mounting that this phenomenon has mutated from trial by social media to more sinister outcomes. From the recent case of YouTube personality Count Dankula being convicted in an actual court of law for the crime of being hashtag grossly offensive, to the sacrificing of young girls to Pakistani Muslim rape gangs in Britain, and now finally to the complete mainstream media silence and general apathy around the suffering of the South African Boer, it seems that the designation racist has become even a death sentence. White privilege, white male tears, reverse racism, all these made-up, nebulous terms and the unidirectional way in which they are applied have now become signals that whites are disqualified from compassion, that the lives of our children will be forfeit, that our individual struggles are irrelevant, and that we will be abandoned and left to fend for ourselves should we face a situation of oppression, and that some among us even delight in our, quote, white suffering. Racist has become a Cold War cry of non-reciprocity, of non-negotiation, of the intent for the fruits of our labour to be stripped from us through our own democracies. It signals the intent to sever us from our history and each other, leaving us atomized and nihilistic. Sorry for our ethnic guilt by association, for a list of historical crimes that are at best lies by half-truth, at worst, complete fabrications. I sympathise with the South African Boer, not only because of the barbarity and tragedy that they face, but also because they are the advance warning of what all European peoples face as non-European populations continue to grow at greater rates than us within our own countries. What was sold to us was the utopian fantasy that we should simply lay down our defences, abandon our religious, cultural and ethnic identities, that what awaits us is a colour-free, individualistic, conflict-free future, with all the peoples of the world uniting as one. But doesn't united mean that we should care for each other equally? If so, where is the non-white outrage at British rape gangs, at the targeted rapes of German and Swedish women, at the prevalence of lawless ghettos in France? Where is the outrage at ethnic advocacy groups such as Black Lives Matter or La Raza, the demand that these groups abandon their ethnic identity? Nowhere to be seen because they get a free pass due to the convenient redefinition of words. Racism now depends on having power, which is left to speak for being a majority demographic. So in the Western world, only white people can now be racist. So then, according to this twisted Orwellian word salad, where is the defence of the white South Africans who are the minority, who have lost institutional power and are now being persecuted by it? Even under this twisted definition of what racism is, it is still not applied consistently when the target of viciousness is people of European descent. What South Africa teaches us is that these utopian narratives are nothing more than exploiting the high trust of European people for the ends of using our own morality as a weapon against us. And so where can this lead for all of us? Well, we have to ask ourselves, do we see any reason to think that these things will end peacefully? The problem is that with every dismissal of European concerns, every signal that our suffering is not regretted but instead laughable, and every celebration of our cultural and ethnic demise, two things are happening. The success of these strategies only emboldens and further incentivizes those who employ them. And reciprocally, the incentive for those they are used against to continually deny their collective identity only erodes further and further away. So what could possibly halt this process? Well, the first thing that would need to happen would be that the shame and parasitized classes would need to become self-aware enough to realize that these ideologies that they employ are mostly just after-the-fact justifications for the fulfillments of their incentives. And then, with that knowledge, they would have to cease their attacks and start living by the universalist and individualist morality that they preach. The second thing that would have to happen is that the shamed class, whites, will need to learn to walk the highly precarious line between refusing to be shamed and guilted for our history, culture, achievements, and civilization, and instead develop a healthy appreciation for these things on the one hand, yet not completely abandoning moral standards and resort to a violent and unapologetic racial unification on the other. Are either of these possible? In my opinion, for some people, yes. For the majority of people, probably not. So with that in mind, my prediction for the next few years is that, on the one hand, there will be significant numbers of honest and intelligent people striving very hard to solve these issues in the intellectual realm, because they see what is coming and they realize that violence is costly and destructive for everyone involved. However, unfortunately, the majority of the population in our societies is made up of the evil, the greedy, and the short-term virtue signalers who manipulate the simple, the ones who will only seriously look beyond their own lives when they are personally affected, by which time it is likely too late anyway. The best case scenario that I can imagine is that these problems grow ever more present in society, more and more average people will be affected, even if not directly, but at least by 1 or 2 degrees of separation. As these problems hit closer and closer to home for the average person, they will grow more and more incentivized to comprehend the scope of the problems that we face. And maybe the best that we can hope for is that a majority of people express that they have reached the end of their tolerance and are prepared to take decisive action, and that this incentivizes a political response rather than a directly violent one. But in the case of the South African whites, I think it's already too little too late. My heart goes out to them, and I hope that at least from now, swift and decisive action is taken to help these people relocate. And I also hope that enough of us in Western countries realize that their experiences serve as a caution for us all.